When the surface and undersea worlds need him the most, Namor the Submariner will ride again. What'll happen next? Well, let's hop into the pages of Namor issue number 1, a brand new series courtesy of Jason Aaron, and find out what happens next together. Shall we? So then, full disclosure, I never actually finished Jason Aaron's run on Avengers, but I can only assume that this story takes place sometime after the events of that book, as Namor is brought to a special UN black site prison for the laundry list of crimes he committed, you know, declaring war on the surface, sinking ships, seducing all the surface women with his Atlantean riz, you know, the usual. The guards here are super vindictive and they decide to go full on Abu Ghraib on Namor. You see, even though he's only half Atlantean, he still needs to touch water every so often. Lest he'll dry out and die, most Atlanteans start going downhill after 3 days, but Prince Namor has managed to hold out for a full 6 weeks and the guards are so mad at him. They've decided to march him out and present him with a bucket of piss. Feeling that it's only a matter of time before he breaks and ends up humiliating himself, of course Namor being Namor, he manages to keep his very regal head held high, instead managing to subsist himself solely on just a couple beads of sweat from these guards. Which only causes to anger them further and they end up dumping the poor bucket on his head. Yep, Namor has been dragged about as low as he could possibly ever been dragged. The worst part being is that he is so defeated, so at the end of his rope, he doesn't even consider escaping back to the ocean ever since he abdicated the throne of Atlantis. Still though, his mind begins to wander and he remembers his early days in Atlantean school. You see, up until then, Namor had been taught solely by his mother and her army of viziers. But Prince Namor was a willful kid and as such, he demanded to attend normal classes with regular everyday Atlanteans, and well, they weren't exactly very nice to him. They called him a pink-skinned half-breed. And as cruel as the kids were, their parents were even more indelicate. One day, a bunch of these kids, led by one particular individual named Chalmers, try and coax Namor to join them on an excursion to the Deep Lake, a place that even Namor's queen mother had told him never to visit. Why? Because it's an underground sulfur leak that poisons and kills anything that's there for too long. The other kids drag Namor out here today in hopes of drowning him in the sulfur. Obviously, Namor was tough even as a kid and is able to fight them off. Though in reality, the real threat out here wasn't the sulfur or the attempted murder, it was actually a massive anglerfish monster that is able to live in such a harsh climate. Yeah, Namor's mom told him about this thing too, and in his internal monologue, he has to say, damn it, why is mom always right about everything? Now, back in the present, Namor's solitude is shattered when a group of blue-skinned Atlantean barbarians end up invading the prison and killing a bunch of the guards. At first, Namor thinks these guys must be here to try and rescue him so that he can once again retake the throne of Atlantis, but quite the opposite. This is a hit squad sent here to kill Namor once and for all. These goons aren't alone either, as they've ended up bringing with them some mercenary muscle in the form of King Crab and Man of War, two members of Namor's own Defenders of the Deep, basically his own aquatic answer to the Avengers. Namor might be a shadow of his former greatness right now, but that still doesn't mean he doesn't know how to whoop ass, which he most definitely does. Namor saves himself and the other guards before eventually passing out due to the poison blades that these assassins keep stabbing him with. When he comes to in the hospital infirmary later on, he's not alone as he's met by Stingray, aka Dr. Newell, the famous oceanographer and occasional friend and ally to Namor. It would seem that Stingray is here for the exact same reason these would-be assassins had come looking for Namor to try and kill him, and that is ever since Namor abandoned the throne of Atlantis, things have only gotten worse underneath the waves. Multiple warring factions and old grudges have ended up rearing their ugly heads as several different factions all try and battle for control of the throne. In fact, things have gotten so bad the UN has decided to dub this brand new conflict World War C, which honestly is just hilarious to me. Namor wonders what the hell makes any of this his problem. He left so he wouldn't have to deal with this kind of crap anymore, but as Stingray explains, the longer all of this Atlantean fighting goes on, the more antsy the militaries of the world start to get. All of this fighting in the ocean is disrupting supply lines. The cruise industry, to say nothing of underwater drilling, and if things keep going the way they are, it's soon going to be open season on all Atlanteans. Stingray says he's even seen the brand new atomic harpoons that the military is working on, and if Namor doesn't come back and try and regain his throne, then he might very well well end up being able to call himself the first mutant and the last Atlantean. With no options left and his conscience thoroughly guilted, Namor suits up and is ready to return to the sea one last time. On his way out, he ends up talking with the guards, who try and thank him for saving their lives. Prince Namor, in classic fashion, says that if he even hears any whispers about these guys abusing other prisoners, then he's gonna get a million hermit crabs to deface every single one of their orifices, and goddamn, that has gotta be one of the most vivid threats I've heard in a while. And it's on that note right there the comic comes to a close, everybody, and so that was Namor issue number one. And full disclosure, I actually had no idea this book was coming out. I saw it on the shelf and was genuinely surprised that Jason Aaron was writing a Namor book, and I mean, really, how could I not dive in? This is the same guy who wrote some of the best modern Wolverine, Thor, and King Conan stories, and I mean, Namor fits perfectly into that genre himself. He's a king, he's a warrior, he's a superhero, he's kind of an asshole. And Aaron does a great job painting him as a stoic badass while also using this opportunity to do some really flowery poetry, as Namor wistfully reminisces about the beauty of Atlantis that he may never well see again. It's also cool to intersperse this story with some flashbacks to Namor's time as a little kid. I feel like we don't get to see that stuff all that often. And how it helped form him into the guy he is today. Also, you just know we're probably gonna end up seeing Chalmers again later on, and that's gonna tie into the bigger overarching story. Ultimately, I would give this one an 8 out of 10. Very pleasantly surprised. And excited to see where this series goes from here. I'm a big Invaders fan, and because of that, I'm a big Namor fan. And despite him getting a huge push there for a little bit after that last Black Panther movie, he kind of fell off the face of the earth, so I'm happy to see him back here in such a big bad way.
Hey there, everyone. It's your old pal Cape Jewel again, thanking you so much for watching to the end of the video. I hope you enjoyed it, and if you did, why not check out my Amazon link down in the description? Yes, that's right. The Cape Jewel channel officially has its own Amazon storefront now. You can pick up a comic or anything else for that matter, and if you did, you'd really be helping me and the channel. So with that out of the way, everyone, I will see you again next time. Bye-bye.